going to tell you three stories, and these stories are in a span of time of 20 years. It was 1981, just after the emergency. Many of us had joined the profession, which was in its best stages then. It was exciting, we were enthusiastic. I was in the Indian Express, and being a crime reporter, I could write on crime as well as any issue that I wanted. And it was at that time that we started writing on, I'll go back to where we were working with great editors. There was Kuldeep Nair, there was Bill Malkonkar, there was Arun Shauri, and we were writing at that time on the Gandhi film. Indian government had played, had given a certain amount of money, a princely sum actually, to a foreign endeavor, which was Richard Attenborough's film called Gandhi. It was at that time that we decided that we would follow this story because it had the Indian film industry up in arms. And expose after expose, story after story, and we had made it our mission that we would follow this on a daily basis, and we would follow and track the secret movements, as it were, of Attenborough and his team in Delhi. There was a lady who was a celebrity. She was well known, well connected, who was the India head. And obviously the stories were hitting home, and she decided to start calling me, a cub reporter at that time, and start actually threatening me that she would come to the owner, Ramnath Goenka, and complain about me. We ignored her until one fine morning when a particularly good, I think, Gandhi film story had hit the headlines in our paper, that Shauri came into the newsroom and said that Ramnath Goenka wanted to meet me. There was pin drop silence in the room, because when the old man wanted to meet a young reporter, it was certainly not good news. Shauri, in the range of those editors who did not desert their reporters, walked with me to what we popularly referred to at that time as the Lion's Den. Walked in and I saw the lady sitting beside Goenka, and looking rather smug to my nervous eyes. And Goenka looked at me and he said, "You're a very mischievous girl." And then followed this amazing conversation where he talked about everything except the reason that had brought the lady to his office. And when he finished talking and we were about to leave, he said that you should always contact her when you do a story. Mind you, he did not say do not do the story. He just said that when you do your next story, contact her for a version. By then I was sort of bristling, my confidence had come back. And so I said, "Oh, you want to me to give her my sources?" Because that is what she had been demanding. And he said, "If you give her your sources, you're out of a job, young lady." And as we moved forward, he called me back and he said, "You have just joined the profession. There will be many you will meet who will tell you that they know me. But once your facts are right, carry on, do the story, ignore them." Fast forward to say another 6-7 years later, towards 1990, India Today. I had just done a story on what was the then defense camp, Bofors, but it was a side story really. It was about the involvement of a minister in that scam. So it wasn't really a major story, but it was a story nevertheless. At 11 o'clock at night, I came back having done the story. The issue was going to bed that night, which meant it was going to be published that night. But I was a little worried because a henchman of the editor, who was also an editor in his own capacity, or had been given that kind of a designation, was a friend of that minister's and was known in the office to have changed stories later at night when you could do nothing about it. So I drove back to the office, and sure enough, my story was being edited. And I looked over the sub-editor's shoulder to see that it was an entirely different story. Instead of being anti the minister, it became pro the minister with new quotes, new paragraphs, the entire thrust had been changed. I insisted that it be pulled out of the paper or of the magazine. And I was told by the editors, and that was of course justifiable, that they could not do it so late in the night. And they had nothing to replace it with. So then I said, you drop my byline. After a long struggle, they finally agreed to drop my byline. I resigned at 2 a.m. in the morning and left because my trust in the publication had been broken. 2004, Asian Age. The India-US civil nuclear agreement. We were writing about it, writing about the news that was not being published. We felt through experts, through others who had written for us, that it was not very favorable to Indian interests, that it would compromise Indian foreign policy. And so there was story after story, which obviously was hurting the government of the day. And how do they stop us? So they got to the one chink in the armor, and that was the owner of the Asian Age, who had great political ambitions. They got to him. The editor-in-chief was fired without a warning. I was the resident editor leading the campaign, as it were. I was called and given an ultimatum that I either follow the new policy or I quit. And so obviously, I quit. So you can see through the three stories that from the benign to the almost malignant, how big money control started squeezing the media and pushing us out of the free and fair space into another space altogether. And this really actually began with the advent of television, which needed the big money, which needed the big industry to come in and control. Control obviously because there was this link between big industry and government, which is a very, very close link that was forged and has strengthened only over the years. The governments at that time also realized that you could not bring back censorship through the government rule. The media had become very sensitive and angry about it. And so this was the new route through which the control was exercised. The media house needed the money. The owners gave the money. The owners or the corporates needed favors from the government, and the government gave them favors in return for a certain understanding. The complexion of the media changed and started changing very fast. The editors became handpicked because obviously there was no scope for the independent, dynamic, courageous editor in this scheme of things. And slowly the professionals were pushed aside, and the people who were brought in were picks of the corporate and the political class. So this is how it sort of continued working for a long time. And truth, of course, was the casualty. It was pushed under the carpet. Inconvenient facts were buried. And without people really realizing it, news started favoring the chosen few. And what was the biggest casualty? The poor. The poor vanished from the news. And even now, when you switch on your television or when you read the main headlines, it is not about the poor. The farmers are marching in Rajasthan. They're marching for their demands. They're struggling and they're protesting in Maharashtra. There are huge demonstrations taking place, but we in the media do not even look at that. We have workers marching through Delhi and through the national capital of India, and we do not even give them a second glance. We don't even have a few centimeters or a headline reserved for them. The poor and the victimized cry themselves hoarse, but we in the media are so busy catering to the glitz, to the glamour, to the rich, to the bold and the beautiful, that we do not even look at the poor and those who need us the most. But of course, if a celebrity has a baby, or if a celebrity or a film star gets married, it becomes the headlines. It's something that we write about, talk about for days at end. There is another new thing that has happened, and that I think is fairly sinister, because this is the first time that the media and we who are committed to the truth have started actually propagating the lie. False news, fake videos. These are things that are coming increasingly onto the mainstream field, where we are doing what actually Chomsky so brilliantly wrote about, that we are manufacturing consent. We are moving continuously into the sphere of lies. We're repeating the lie and the half-truth in the hope that it becomes the truth. This is extremely dangerous because this has taken us into an entirely new field, as in Jawaharlal Nehru University maybe started it a few years ago, when a fake video was constantly telecast by so-called mainstream channels as if it was the truth. Why? To pillory and to vilify a bunch of students who were starting out in life. In the process, in following our corporate masters and the kind of liaison that is built between the media and the corporate and the moneyed class, we have started resembling that class. We started actually acquiring the characteristics of the corporate and the big industry. Instead of being irreverent, which is what the media is supposed to be, we are becoming conformist. Instead of being bold, we are becoming overcautious. Instead of being courageous, we are becoming fearful. Instead of sticking to the truth and the facts, we are obfuscating facts. And instead of writing for the poor and speaking about the poor, we are now writing about the rich and holding mega events for the big, rich and the powerful instead of going into the field. And to the point where now the corporates who run us and the industry who runs us and the government who runs industry actually own what we think. Not only what we say, but also what we think. What are we in the media? What are we all about? We are basically communicators. We are not celebrities. We are not stars. When we started out in the profession, major newspapers, including the Patriot, Statesman, Hindu, they refused to give you your byline no matter how great your story was. But today we are stars and we are celebrities. We also do not have any caste or religion or creed. We are just reporters in the field. When we walk into a situation, we walk in as a reporter, not as a person carrying her caste or her religion on her sleeve. This was always the atmosphere. Believe you me, I've covered communal violence all over this country, be it Kashmir, be it Punjab, Assam, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, wherever. Not even once did I go into the affected zone and have even one citizen of India ask me what my religion was. Never. My gender is visible, and all that I needed to say was, I'm a journalist. That's all that counted. And the third thing that I do think I should stress on here is objectivity. Everybody says journalism and the media is objective. No, we are not. We are not required to be. How can we be when the masses of India are the poor and the struggling, where they are not on the same scale as you and I, the more privileged in this room? How can we be objective when we report about the truth, about the poor? How can we be objective when we walk into a conflict zone and see that one section of the people, the poorest, are being hit? There is nothing like objectivity. Like I said earlier, we are here for the Constitution and the law so that our prejudice and our bias is controlled. But we are here to report the truth. Let me give you one example. It was 1984, there was this anti-Sikh violence, and we had just heard that in Trilokpuri there was a major carnage. We had heard some vague rumors because nothing that worked was visible in Delhi. It was only flames and smoke. There was no police, there was no authority. Everybody had gone indoors, everything was deserted. So I and my photographer we took an old ambassador car and we drove into Trilokpuri, and we saw people running around. You know, they were running away as soon as they saw this ambassador car, which was synonymous with government, I guess. We wondered who these people were, and then we saw a number of bonfires that were burning. What are they burning? So we stopped, went to the first bonfire, and there was this initial shock, which came back later in the form of nightmares. But at that moment, we had to numb that feeling, because there were bodies being burnt in that bonfire. And we had to count the number of bodies in each of those several bonfires to get an idea of how many people had been killed. We came back to the office with the story, and we wanted the editors to do away with the old practice. And there was this old practice, which was a good practice, it was an ethical practice, of not naming the community in a violence. But here, this violence was not a riot, it was one-sided. And we insisted that they should identify the community, because we said that that community was being attacked on the basis of rumors. It was being lynched on the basis of rumors. And if we play that equal card, then we will continue to feed those rumors. So we have to identify it. The senior editors went into a huddle. It took a long time. But then they finally agreed, and we actually identified the community. And we do feel that that helped, because it did help in quenching the rumors. We are thus, and we are very, very aware of it. We are the fourth pillar of democracy. We're not the constitutional pillar, but we are the watchdog that looks at all the other four pillars, that keeps them in check. And the only way to do that is to by speaking the truth, not by speaking the lie. Because when we lie for others. When we obfuscate the truth, when we compromise ourselves and the dignity of the media, then we allow the executive to run amok. We allow the legislature to become irresponsible and unaccountable. And we allow the judiciary to become a prisoner of its own weaknesses. And this is something we cannot allow. We are a resilient, important institution, and somewhere we had lost sight of it. If you look around and you go back home at night and you look at television, you will find the degeneration, as it were, of the media. You will hear us shouting at the top of our voices. You will see us playing the role of jury, judge, and hangman. You will see that we are attacking everybody on the basis of some information from the authorities, and we are damning them as criminals, as terrorists, as killers, without ever having followed their stories. If we do not have the capability to actually confirm and reconfirm, then we should at least have the capability of bringing back the language that is so important. And using those phrases, it is alleged, it is reported. We are not, as the anchors and the journalists, the all-knowing. If we are accepting what the authorities tell us, we have to add, or anyone tells us, and we have not been able to verify from secondary and third and fourth sources, then we have to say it is reported. This language has to come back. We have sort of thrown ethics out of the window. We don't have ethics anymore. I mean, and I'll give you a very simple example, which many of you would have seen if you watch television, is when in a conflict situation where some family has been the victim of utmost savagery, you go in, you send in the pretty young thing with a mic, she sticks the mic into the face of the victim or the survivors and says something as banal and as unjournalistic as, "Oh, now tell us, how does it feel now that your son has died?" And this is over and over again. Where is the compassion? Where is the ethics? Where is the responsibility? After all, journalism comes packaged in all these values and all these virtues, as it were. Instead, we sit and we advocate war. We talk about war, we propagate war. We are here as journalists across the world for peace. There is a certain doctrine to which journalism is committed. It is always for the underdog. We are not here to propagate government achievements or what the corporates do. We are here to write about the truth in the field, about how people are suffering, what they are going through. And that is the story that we have to bring to you. Also, we have to stand for peace, because war brings with it devastation. And journalists as the watchdog have to ensure peace, or at least write for peace. Today, we propagate war, we advocate war, we create the other, we demonize the other, we feed into stereotypes, and when nothing works, we bring in fake news, we bring in half lies, and then we tell you, we are the media, respect us, and do what we want you to say. I think the problem then is that we are not really liked anymore. And that has become a very, very major problem where we are concerned. There was a time when we went out into the field and we'd be surrounded by people who would come, they would give us tea. I'm not saying because of tea, but there was a respect. They wanted to talk to us. You will take our story to Delhi. You will take our story to Lucknow. You will highlight what you're saying. We know, we trust you, we don't trust anyone else. This was the kind of response we always got. And that made you feel good, that made you feel proud, that made you feel, yes, you were doing the right thing. But today, when we go into the field, they say, we don't trust you, we don't like you. Just a few weeks ago, a few months ago, we were in Western UP, going from town to town to assess the impact of demonetization on poor industry, on the poor worker, on the poor laborer. Everywhere we went and stopped, they would surround us, they would talk to us, but they would tell us, we don't trust you, what are you doing here? You're going to write, but you're not going to write for us. You're going to write for the big people. And some would say it to us directly, others would stand around us and speak to each other, but within earshot, so that we heard, oh, she's just a journalist. These journalists cannot be trusted. Why do we need to even go near them? And this is all over the place. And why not? We have done this to ourselves. We have stopped the people from liking us. We have stopped the people from trusting us. And we have actually not just stopped them, but we've also destroyed that foundation for that kind of trust, which of course is absolutely terrible. Well, we have a space now, you know, with all this kind of control and the kind of intervention that there is from the big powers that be, and the way in which we in the media have crumbled. We have a space on the internet. Many of us who were fed up and refused to compromise and move from job to job searching what you would call utopia, but finding a sort of a level playing field, which we actually did not. And so we moved into the internet and we started our own publications. Why? Because it was cheap. It was cheaper. It was easy to do. Of course, now the corporates have discovered the freedom of the digital space and they're entering that space with philanthropic funding, with direct investments, with big money. But even so, like, ventures like ours, maybe the citizen, which is modest, it can survive. It can survive on the basis of public sourcing, of public funding, of contributions, of subscriptions. It might not be able to compete with the Times of India, but it does hold its own, and at least it does honest journalism. And that today is very, very important. Honest, courageous, bold journalism, we have to bring it back. At the same time, we have to reclaim the space of the print media and television. We have to end those monopolies, the single media house and monopolies. We have to end that control. And we can only do it through the citizen, through you, through public funding, through public cooperatives, where people come together and realize how important the institution of the media is, how important it is to keep it as an independent pillar and a strong and a resilient watchdog, and then perhaps contribute to set up some public broadcasting, public television, or again, public owned and controlled media. This is so important. I don't know if this is going to happen. I don't know if we are ever going to go close to that, but I sure hope we will. And meanwhile, I think all of us are in the same journey. We journalists and you citizens who we confuse on a daily basis, we have to reclaim the truth before it is too late.